Thank you very much for the invitation. This is an adapted version of a small part of my book, The Theology of Food, Eating and the Eucharist, which was recently published by Willy Blackwell in February this past year. And this is part of the last chapter, the fourth chapter, where I talk about theology and politics of food. And I call this blending of theology and politics, theopolitics. And I use as the most, the main idea, main metaphor, the movie and also the story of Isaac Dinesen's Babette's Feast that Richard Finn made reference to. And I compare that with the manna tradition in the scriptures, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. So I go back and forth to that. And this part is more talking from these discussions on the gift, which is a theological and philosophical discussion on the gift. But here in this paper, I'll take the gift from the perspective of alimentation or nourishment, using the gift as nourishment and nourishment as gift. So I hope that this could be food for thought and thought for food for all of you. I will briefly explore the notion of the gift, particularly as it regards the practice of alimentation or nourishment, which is an analogy common to both Babette's and God's feast. The strange manna is said to be a gift from heaven, which, as Babette's culinary gift, brings about communal nourishment and transformation. I will argue that this relationship between gift, nourishment, and self-other transformation sheds light on the meaning of the Eucharistic sharing, and I will hope serve as a basis for better understanding what is meant by the theopolitics of sharing in the body of Christ. This correlation between nourishment and gift is not at all a novel discovery. Louis Hyde correctly points out that several anthropological, social, and cultural studies on the gift make direct reference to food practices that reflect both a metaphorical expression and a material performance of the gift and gift exchange social systems. The now classic work by Marcel Mauss, Essai sur le don, reflects an archaic societies wherein a system of gift exchange is frequently centered on food, or where durable goods are treated as food. The practice of potlatch by Northwest American tribal groups, for instance, is frequently translated by Mauss as nourishing or consuming if it is used as a verb, or feeder or place of being satiated if it is used as a noun. Potlatch is a complex gift exchange system that creates social bonds in these groups. But the gift is never static, for it is enacted in its being received or consumed. Thus, regarding this aspect of the edibility of the gift, Hyde reflects, and I quote him, "Another way to describe the motion of the gift is to say that the gift must always be used up, consumed, eaten. The gift is a property that perishes. Food is one of the most common images for the gift, because it is so obviously consumed. Even when the gift is not food, when it is something we would think of as a durable good, it is often referred to as a thing to be eaten." The notion of the edible gift thus displays a dimension of giving and receiving that constitutes social relations. In pre-industrial agricultural societies, food is also meant to be a gift given not only by other people, but also by the earth or nature, and often by spiritual beings, gods and goddesses. Food as gift and gift as food show a dimension of interdependence between social groups and of humanity with the earth and with divine agency. But the gift is fully performed in the act of receiving, eating, and consuming it. In this act of reception, there is a sense of being nourished by the gift that is shared by other people, nature, and supernatural entities. Nourishment is conceived as it is received, as it is eaten. Likewise, we speak of the gift in the midst of its giving, when it is already somehow altered by our reception, which here, following Moss and Hyde, I call consumption. There is always a mediatory or digestive process in the reception of otherness, whether this is a piece of bread or another person. The giving of the gift does not annul or inhibit the recipient's creativity and innovativeness, which are displayed in the process of receiving or digesting the gift. The other is a gift, an edible gift. Thus, I emphasize the element of the gift's consumption because there is an aspect of kenosis, of giving out of self, of this possession. There is an aspect of kenosis in the gift, and it must undergo in order to be received. In the gift, there is a risk, a kenotic performance, but in the most fleshy and extremely intimate sense of proximity, to the extent that it is broken apart and consumed until it enters our very flesh and further transforms itself into energy, words, and deeds. Thus, regarding the Eucharist, since one of the most primal forms of sharing is nourishment, one could state that it is suitable or convenient, in Aquinas' sense of conveniencia, that Christ's donation is, par excellence, precisely given as food and drink. There is also a dimension of aesthetics in Christ becoming precisely bread and wine. For instance, bread can be used to stand for food in general, and wine is an intoxicating drink that lifts the spirits. It is also fitting that just as sin is brought into the world through eating the forbidden fruit, now the eating and drinking of the Eucharistic meal is a practice of salvation and deification. Redemption is prompted by sensual experience, particularly through the most intense and penetrating senses such as touch and taste, which in the Eucharist give guidance to both the intellect and the soul. Since God is always in excess, this aesthetic manifestation is only an analogical dimension of His beauty, which also includes divine truth and goodness. Nevertheless, the fittingness of God becoming incarnate as human and becoming Eucharistic nourishment allows us to conjecture on the dimension of co-belonging, which is also a form of ontological affinity between God and His creatures. This divine-human co-belonging is made possible by God's self-sharing, precisely in ways appropriate to the human capacity to receive the divine gift, as food and drink in the Eucharist, for instance. The kenosis of the Eucharistic gift is a self-immersion of Christ with the Holy Spirit into finite humanity and materiality. In the Eucharist, divinity takes the risk of becoming food because of a desire to indwell or abide in the beloved, just as food becomes a part of the eater. But in this kenotic giving, there is not only a self-immersion of the supernatural in the natural. This conveniencia of the incarnation, as well as the Eucharistic feeding, allows the elevation of the human condition to the supernatural, a tendency or forward direction toward a deeper reality of intimacy with God, as in the beatific vision and the final destination at the eschaton. In this kenotic act, desire and self-expression, though consumed or digested by the recipient, are never suppressed or annihilated by the act of reception. Manna is also a gift that expresses God's desire to be near to and redeem and nurture His people. This is also the case with the Eucharistic sharing, in which God's desire and self-expression are given as food and drink in a fashion parallel to the way in which Tita in Laura's prevails like water for chocolate. I don't know if you saw this Mexican film. Tita is the main character, and she cooks for every time for everyone, and she impregnates her feelings and her emotions in the food that she cooks. So it's very parallel to Laura Esquivel's Water for Chocolate, because makes food an extension of her desire and self-expression, and as Babette's feast is an expression of her own self. There is a delight in the giving of the gift which Pache, Mos, Hyde, et al. Is imperishable despite its being consumed. And in God, desire and self-expression constitute one and the same divine gift. For the divine gift is God's language of love that nourishes the life of the Trinity. Such a divine nourishment, the substance or usia that is intra-divine love, is further shared perpetually and despite our refusal in the Eucharistic banquet. From a Trinitarian perspective, the threefold aspects of the gift that are the giver, the given, and the giving infinitely coincide in this perpetually ecstatic exchange. Or, if I am permitted to use an alimentary analogy, one could say that in God's ecstatic exchange, there is a coincidence and dynamic interplay between the cook, the meal, and banqueting. That is why the divine gift allows a conjecture on the coincidence between agape and eros. It is agapeic, erotic at once. For the desire of the other, it is as intense as the desire to give to the other. This giving is an initial self-giving to the other as much as it is a return as thanksgiving to the giver. Such is the superabundance and infinite dynamism of the divine gift, which David Bentley Hart articulates as follows, and I quote, "The Father gives himself to the Son, and again to the Spirit, and the Son offers everything up to the Father in the Spirit, and the Spirit returns all to the Father through the Son eternally. Love of, the gift to, and delight in the other is one infinite dynamism of giving and receiving, in which desire at once beholds and donates the other." End of quote. The divine gift, which is God's desire and self-expression, is not only imperishable, but allows the transformation of the recipient. In fact, the recipient becomes fully him or herself in this act of reception. For this reason, the reception is also an expression of gratitude. The word in Greek is Eucharistos, for this divine gift. In the Eucharistic sharing, while Christ abides in the one who partakes of his flesh and blood, the partaker is also transformed in the reverse direction and incorporated into the body of Christ. The partaker becomes Eucharistic. The self is a joyful expression of thanksgiving for becoming recipient of such a divine gift. In the words of Hart, I quote, "One becomes a person, one may say, analogous to the divine persons, only insofar as one is the determinate recipient of a gift. One is a person always in the evocation of a response." End of quote. From a communal perspective, the body of Christ is his self-expression, his desire as self-giving that is repeated, not identically, by the further communal sharing of such a divine gift. Therefore, the message of the Eucharist is that the communal body of Christ is a dynamic in-betweenness of the giving, receiving, and charitable sharing of God's gift. Divine and human desires enter into a deep sense of intimacy and reciprocity in this agapeic, erotic, holy communion that is the Eucharistic ecclesial performance. From a Christian perspective, the paradigm of kenosis of the gift given to be consumed intimates this possession as an act that does not make self-sacrifice an end in itself, but in the context of the resurrection, it becomes a practice of hope, gratitude, and trust for a returning God's superabundant love and fidelity. Still prior to the resurrection, the divine gift is an expression of the superabundant charity and joy that is perfect in the shared life of the Trinity, and in him, desire and selfless charity are one and the same. Accordingly, there is a paradox in the gift. While being superabundant, it cannot be fully possessed. It moves beyond itself in giving itself away. There will be no fear in giving away or letting go. The paradox is comparable to the Gospel's discourse on the Beatitudes, where the gift is both kenosis and plenitude, as it reveals the essential character of blessedness in the practice of being fulfilled by way of this possession. The paradoxical message of the Beatitudes is rooted in communion with and commitment to one another, and is never merely individual devotional practice or one seeking personal salvation. Martyrdom is understood in this dimension of the paradox of kenosis, a commitment to life, even when there might be death involved. Such, for instance, is the understanding of many martyrs in Latin America. As the General Master of the Jesuits, Father Piet Hans Kovenbach, expressed it in 1983, and I quote him, "For reflection on the Beatitudes to be authentic, it has to be founded on a communion of life and death, as shown by our Lord, with the poor and those who weep, with victims of injustice and those who hunger." End of quote. Giving is also learning to let go, for in generous giving, there is an implicit return, even when this return is never identical, even when there is a delay in returning. For if there is generosity and gratitude at all, the gift surpasses exact calculations of time and quantity. But this only shows that delay, not identical repetition, and perpetual giving are the life of the true gift. The paradoxical beatific dimension of the gift also recalls Babette's own letting go of all her fortune for the making of a lavish meal that she offers to the community, knowing that her kenotic gesture will not end in absolute scarcity, for her gift is already an expression of superabundance of art, and she says, "An artist is never poor." In Isaac Dinesen's story, Babette interrupts the narrative of the village people and brings a gift that allows the community to enter into a new self and communal realization, a harmonious unity between the spiritual and the bodily, a deeper and more intense form of relationality with one another and with God. At first sight, one could argue that the Hebrew and Christian manna is also an interruption. The manna is a gift that interrupts a community that hungers and is near to losing hope, and opens up a new collective realization of being loved by God, who nourishes his people and gives hope for a promised collective future. From a Christian perspective, one could also say that God interrupts historicity by becoming incarnate and further becoming food and drink as an act of self-sharing, as well as an invitation to share with one another this divine gift. An initial reflection could lead one to argue that the Eucharistic performance is thus interruptive. Yet, from a Christian angle, there is more in the Eucharistic gift than mere interruption. The bread of eternal life, that is Christ, is not merely extrinsic and unilateral intervention. Undoubtedly, it is an instance of a freely giving love and grace initiated by a prior intra-Trinitarian reciprocal love, which is further shared ex nihilo with creation. But for this same reason, the divine gift is already both reciprocal and intrinsic or inherent in creation. All creation is a gift. Its isness is as much a gift as it is gratitude. Being is already a gift from the Creator and participates in divinity. The Sofianicity of being, I'm using this term Sofianic from Bulgakov, he's a Russian Orthodox theologian, and he uses the term Sofianic to talk about something divine already in creation, that creation is already participatory of divine agency. So he calls that participation Sophianic. So this Sophianicity of being is the gift character of all that is by virtue of being nourished by God's wisdom and love. The same goes for creatures who, as John Milman correctly explains from following the Lubbock, are not merely recipients of the divine gift, since they are already themselves this gift. The capacity to receive is already a gift to a gift. Incarnation and the Eucharist enter into the heart of the flesh of human pathos in order to recover and reorient what is somehow already there, and it becomes more itself through God's plenitudinous sharing, that is the incarnate Logos. One could say then that more than a mere interruption, there is the Eucharistic gift is a completion of both creation and humanity. The divine gift sets in motion the possibility of accomplishment or fulfillment of such a deifying process. The Eucharist intensifies this intrinsic gift character of creation and further performs a rich mixture of gift exchanges that go from inter-Trinitarian exchange to an exchange of divinity with both materiality and humanity, and which is then presented as a doxological return of the gift to God in Christ, Christ's perfect self-offering at the altar, and within concrete communities gathered in the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Eucharistic sharing reorients space and time by reawakening of a memorial of God's self-sharing with all that already is, while envisioning a more plenitudinous sphere of this isness that is allegorized as a collective future eschatological wedding banquet, the final feast yet to come. Babette turns her culinary gift into a love affair that satiates both physical and spiritual hungers. Similarly, the Eucharist tells of God as an edible gift, freely given out of a reciprocal intra-Trinitarian love that feeds humanity's longings by making them intimate, beloved companions at this delightful banquet of love. And this sharing brings about transformation, deification, which is not suppression, by providing physical and spiritual nourishment. And simultaneously, because it is excessive, it promises yet more to taste. Praying to Abba to give us today our daily bread means to be constantly, daily nourished, while being constantly renewed by the desire, the appetite for yet more to be given. While there is transformation, being and the created order are not at all surpassed or cancelled in this receiving and sharing of the divine gift. The Eucharistic gift reaffirms the materiality of bread and wine, the body and the senses. It affirms humanity and expresses a radical solidarity toward those who hunger and are outcast, as Matthew 25 tells us. There is a highly flavored sense of mutuality in play here, for divine agency through the incarnation takes place within a gesture of hospitality offered by humanity. For instance, Mary's fiat becomes, in the midst of grace, the welcoming receptivity of humanity to the divine gift sent by the Holy Spirit. This is parallel to Babette, the stranger who is welcomed and whose gift therefore expresses itself already in the midst of hospitality. One could say that the paradigm in Babette's feast displays the gift as already taking place on some level of exchange rather than being merely the reception of a unilateral gift. And regarding the Eucharistic gift, the fact that there is a specific historical narrative, embodiment, bread and wine, a gathered community, a liturgical and sacramental space and time, and so on, expresses the complex system of gift exchange that is staged or performed in the Eucharistic sharing. The Eucharistic sharing is a performance of relationality wherein self and other are mutually complementing and constituting. this reciprocal dimension of the Eucharistic gift sharply displays what I have called the complex entanglement of the in-betweenness of being. I'm using this term in-betweenness from William Desmond's analysis of the in-betweenness of being. So it's immanent, transcendent, human, divine, material, spiritual, nature, grace, and so forth. The Eucharistic gift, which is always expressed as a dynamic sharing, deconstructs and moves beyond antagonizing dichotomies. This dynamic sharing is enacted at the heart of situatedness, that which is the locus wherein the in-betweenness coincides. If we use a visual image, we could paraphrase James Smith by saying that the Eucharistic sharing is a performance at the stage of the world wherein the invisible is seen in the visible, such that seeing the visible is to see more than the visible. This zone of immanence is where transcendence plays itself out, unfolding itself in a way that is staged by the Creator. But this Eucharistic performance is much more than a visual or audible experience, for this form of divine alimentation also involves higher and deeper levels of agapeic, erotic intimacy, such as touching, tasting, eating, and drinking. The Trinitarian intrinsic sharing of the superabundant divine gift is further shared within humanity as Christ's own body and blood. This divine self-sharing as food and drink, this sacred banquet, reminds us that God is attentive to the most primary needs of his people, for he not only brings about physical and spiritual nourishment, but also incorporates the partakers into his own Trinitarian community. As God becomes bread from heaven in order to nourish and constitute his own body, so the members of the ecclesial community are called to nourish one another. From an ecclesial perspective, founded upon the Eucharist, the public communal and celebratory circulation of the gift shapes the life of the polis. There's this Greek term from political, comes from polis, so it's a community that is formed, in this case, by this nourishment. In view of this sharing in the divine and in the same divine body, the Eucharistic practice presents a great challenge to both the Church and to the entire world. Eliko Jao Hams puts it succinctly, and I quote, "Sharing at Jesus' table means extending it for more people, making more space for others to eat, finding fulfillment in setting the table for those who are hungry. The table extended in this way becomes a feast, a banquet at which humankind and divine mystery mingle in mutual fellowship." End of quote. In this current, increasingly globalized world, superabundance becomes paradoxical, if not scandalous. Few people live in opulence, yet a great number live in extreme poverty. As Marion Nestle and Samuel Wells argue, the problem is not so much a lack of resources. The real problem is that the human refusal to share and care for one another, particularly those who are in most need in our midst. A clear example of this is the realities of world hunger and malnutrition, which are as pervasive as extreme poverty. More than 1 billion people subsist on less than $1 a day, and more than 800 million people have too little to eat to meet their daily energy needs. I agree with Fray Beto, who points out that alleviating hunger is not just about giving food to people or making donations, but also requires a more holistic action that targets structural change. And I quote him, "The aim is to mobilize world resources under UN supervision in order to finance entrepreneurial schemes, cooperative movements, and sustainable development in the poorest regions. Hunger cannot be fought just through donations or even by transfer funds. These need to be complemented by effective policies of structural change such as agrarian and fiscal reforms that are capable of lessening the concentration of income from land and financial dealings. And all this has to be guaranteed by a daring policy of loans and credit offered to beneficiary families who must become the target of an intense educational program so that they can become socioeconomic units and active agents in political and historical processes, end of quote. Alleviating hunger also requires a theopolitical vision rooted in Eucharistic sharing to promote the sort of structural changes that Fray Beto advocates. For prior and even counter to the hegemony of the policy of the secular state, which emphasizes property rights and runs the risk of treating humans as merely individual parties to a contract, the Eucharistic sharing and visioning of co-abiding with a Trinitarian God ensures that people are embraced as integral members of the same divine body, a divine gift that cannot be privately possessed by anyone since, as I have argued, it is already a communally shared reality. This Eucharistic envisioning of the edible gift claims that food matters, precisely because at the heart of the material, that is an entanglement of social, economic, cultural, and political realities, there is a theological realm, which is the co-abiding of divinity with humanity. The body politic of the Church is then centered on a practice of table fellowship, where sharing is enactment of participation or co-belonging with one another, humanity with creation, and the whole of creation with God. In this body and at this table, all the members are interdependent. The interdependence, which is the catholicity of Christ's body, configures a complex sense of spatiality where the universal and the local, the living and the dead, transcendence and immanence belong together, yet without annihilating each other, but instead celebrating harmonious difference. In addition, the catholicity of this body also configures a complex sense of temporality, wherein past, present, and future, chronos and kairos, also belong together without annulling one another. The complex spatiality and temporality of the ecclesial body enable us to reach beyond secular boundaries, wherein the private and public, the political and the religious are often mutually antagonizing. By embodying a participatory politics of God's kingdom, the ecclesial body can open up a space where everyone, particularly the outcast, is spiritually and physically nourished. And this reaching out to the outcast also challenges borders set up by Christendom, for by virtue of divine participation, God's kingdom is always in excess of institutional margins, as Jesus' parable of the Good Samaritan continues to teach and challenge us all. It's a particular challenge to Christians. It is not too surprising that one of the most profitable business in the U.S. is precisely the food industry. In capitalist societies, the notion of overabundance is used as a tool to manipulate human desire, eros. In this configuration of eros, desire is always a lack, thus a need for more, since not only can nothing fully satisfy, but also desire itself generates more desire in a perpetual and obsessive cycle. Octavio Paz points out at the irony of the liberal market of post-industrial capitalism that has brought about overabundance, but has converted Eros into one of its employees. The capitalist practice of overabundance corrupts desire by, on the one hand, putting it in the context of perpetually unsatisfied desire for an empty, because perpetually lacking sign, searching for more. Yet, on the other hand, this practice also claims total ownership over acquired goods. In doing so, it promotes competition and rivalry, which further ruptures the sociality, a sense of co-belonging and sharing of desire. Moreover, in the current era of capitalist globalization, the connection between what we put into our mouths and the human labor implied in producing it, as well as that of what we eat in the ecological dimension of food, is rapidly disappearing. And needless to say, the awareness of the relation between our food at the table and God's gracious sharing is virtually lost. The Eucharistic meal exposes these broken realities of our own eating practices, massive food waste, labor exploitation, and lack of an effective practice of sharing food with our neighbor. For we must not forget that divine superabundance equals God's generosity and hospitality, and as such, it presents a challenge to the greediness of capitalist consumerism. Thus, the erotic, agape, Eucharistic gift, a superabundant gift of alimentation, could serve as a counter-practice to this capitalist crafting of desire. The theopolitical practice of the Eucharistic Ecclesia orients and disciplines desires towards God and towards making communion with one another. And conclusion. Nourishment is the gift that heals hunger, a gift that nourishes our basic hunger for one another. Nourishment as gift and gift as nourishment display a political dimension of interdependence which takes place in a complex dynamic of gift exchange. At the heart of the cosmos, there is an intimate metabolic exchange of nourishing and being nourished, a cosmic banquet, to recall Bulgakov's notion. But as I have already argued, from a Trinitarian, Sophianic, and Eucharistic perspective, the gift, hunger, or appetite, which is ultimately a desire for God, is not a mark of mere lacking or privation. Instead, and by virtue of God's superabundance, desire is a mark of excess, plenitude, and sharing. In this giving and sharing of divine desire in the form of food and drink, Christianity proclaims to be incorporated into the body of Christ, which already shares in the eternal gift of the Trinity. Gerald Loffin puts it as follows, and I quote, "Gift and given, Christ and the donees who receive him are one. To receive the gift of God is to become incorporated into the triune life, into the eternity of donation, of giving and receiving back again. Indeed, the unity of the body of Christ is the unity of giver, gift, and given, of teller, story, and listener, of playwright, play, and player, of host, meal, and guest. And the unity of the body is the presence given in the present of the Eucharist." End of quote. The excess and delight in sharing the edible gift that is God's becoming nourishment is, like Babette's feast, transformative. It constitutes the theopolitics of an agapeic erotic community of mutual givers that is the body of Christ, that which makes the ecclesial community. To receive the divine edible gift is thus both an individual and a communal vocation to also become, by imitatio trinitatis, nourishment. Beyond mere abstraction and speculation, this alimentary participation in the body of Christ leads to a practice, because it is already inaugurated by a Trinitarian divine practice, that shapes and gives meaning to the theopolitics of the Church. On more than one occasion, I have insisted that without caritas, we starve to death. Without caritas, we starve to death. Thus, my argument here is not only about participation, but, and to far a greater extent, about the performance of caritas. The performance of caritas implies, as Pope Benedict XVI remarks in his first encyclical letter, Deus Caritas Est, to enter into the very dynamic of divine self-giving, which is God's nourishing love. And I quote him, "The ancient world had dimly perceived that man's real food, what truly nourishes him as man, is ultimately the Logos, eternal wisdom. This same Logos now truly becomes food for us as love. The Eucharist draws us into Jesus' act of self-oblation. More than just statically receiving the incarnate Logos, we enter into the very dynamic of his self-giving and of food. The Eucharistic banqueting is participation in and performance of, within a complex dimension of space and time, divine caritas. It calls for creating concrete communities where communal sharing is as much a vocation as it is a challenge to our own global economies of scarcity and greed. At that precise wounded spot where superabundance is the void of divine sharing. As an alternative to a model of political practice founded upon the atomization of communities in contractual relations, I propose envisioning and enacting a holy Eucharistic communion with one another and with God, who shares divinity by becoming manna, nourishment itself.
Thank you for getting us off to such a tremendous start with that very deep theological reflection. Could I just check, Richard, as well as the book, the text of that, can we make it available on the website?
We're hoping both to have a text and a video on the website.
Okay, so we can take it a bit further out.
Yes, I'll bring it later. Someone, Mike Jankovic, right now is taking a look at the book, but I'll bring it during the day, so you can take a look. And also, if people are interested in buying the book, we can get a discount from Blackwell. I just have to give you an email address, and you can get a very good discount.
Excellent. So, good. Because I think there's plenty for us to work on there, and brought everything together in a way. There's paragraphs and passages we could just work with. Perhaps if we could take some comments and questions in a moment, but if people would like to, if people want to take the seats around the table. Yeah.